And now that we have created our awesome Orchard Core application, probably it's a bit of a time to also optimize it, because it might not be that fast as you wish. So if there are any performance issues, let's see what you can do. Well, first of all, the best is to not have performance issues. So we have taken a look at two good techniques, but still not silver bullets, but generally usable good techniques to not have performance issues. One of them we have looked at when writing our migrations class. So of course, one very straightforward solution to some database performance problems is using SQL indices that we have created here for our person parse index. SQL indices make filtering and ordering on specific SQL columns faster. It highly depends on what kind of queries you're running on the database table, which indices will be the best. But as a general basic rule of thumb, if you are doing a lot of filtering on ordering or on a specific column, just add an index for it like here, like we have done here. If you are doing a lot of queries where you filter on order on multiple columns, and those columns are commonly pretty much the same, then add a composite index for them for all of the columns at once in a single index. And that can make database operations a lot faster. Also, it's the fastest not to do work that you don't actually have to do. So only fetch data from the database that you actually need. Do paging in SQL queries. So you are not fetching everything, but rather you are just fetching a couple of items at once. Naturally, don't do anything else that you don't need to, and at least don't do it twice. And we have seen caching, how caching works. Here under our cache controller, caching helps you only do performance-heavy computations or slow data fetching just once, and then cache the results, store the results in the temporary cache for a set amount of time or until you want to explicitly invalidate it because you know that the data has changed. Now, all of the general ASP.NET Core and web application performance advices here in Orchard still apply. So, for example, use HTTP2 or even something later for the protocol, not HTTP 1.1, because it will be faster in modern browsers. Use a separate cookie-less domain for static resources. That can help static resource loading a lot, because it doesn't really matter how fast your server responds if then you have a lot of static resources, CSS files, slow JavaScript scripts, huge images that the client needs to load, and the user is still sitting there. Also, as you have seen throughout our Dojo course, Orchard exposes a lot of async APIs. So utilize them accordingly. Don't do synchronous I/O when you are doing file or network operations. Always use async APIs. That helps the throughput of your server a lot, because that way your server won't wait for I/O operations to finish and block a thread while it's doing that. But rather, in the meantime, it will do something else, serve other users, and when the I/O operation finishes, it will resume working there, which is the efficient way of doing that. But let's see a quick check on what you can do if something appears slow. So we won't need these things here, but we'll go back to the browser once the application launches. Let me launch it. What we'll quickly take a look at will be Mini Profiler. Mini Profiler is, as the name also suggests, a profiler, and it's a small one. as the name also suggests. It's a very simple profiler that you can use from the browser. A profiler is a tool, a developer tool that you can use to see what takes how much time in your application. Because if a page load is slow, that doesn't mean that you will know right away what in that page load is slow, which operation takes the most time. And then the question begs itself why it takes that much time. But the first step, in any case, is to figure out what is actually slow. And Mini Profiler can help a lot with that. Mini Profiler has its documentation in the Orchard Doc site. Mini Profiler is actually not an Orchard feature. I mean, it's packaged up as an Orchard module, but it's actually an open source project, which is generally usable in .NET, and as you can see, not just .NET. So let's see how it works. It's very simple to use. It's a bit less simple to understand the results, but we'll get there. As I said, it's packaged up as a module, so you can just simply enable its corresponding feature under feature on the admin here. Mini Profiler, yep. And now you can also configure it to run on the admin, but by default it won't do that. But rather, it will only appear on the front end here. So, yeah, there is a bit of a noise, but if I reload this page, you see that we have this little widget in the top left corner here. Well, it gets faster and faster to an extent. The reason is that there is also just-in-time compilation happening for .NET, so code gets compiled on the fly and it gets faster and faster, but that compilation initially takes time. Furthermore, there can be caches that get filled with data, both in Orchard and in the database engine. So usually, it's not the first page load that's representative of the performance of your application, unless you want to specifically optimize that first page load. But it's not just a millisecond value here. If you open this, we also see some data. Let's open share here so we can get a full screen view of the whole thing. What Mini Profiler shows is, well, how much each of the steps in the application or each of the operations took. And it's very useful to pinpoint database issues. It's also useful for other things being slow, but database issues is kind of the best thing here. As you can see, well, we already see the controller and action that we accessed here is the item controller from OrchardCore.contents, because what we open here is the block content item. So that's our home page. We see that it took 35 milliseconds on the server side at least. Yeah, there's a timestamp, and here is the good stuff. We see each of these operations, how long it took. It depends on what Mini Profiler is actually instrumenting here. So you won't see all the methods and everything, just what it specifically knows about. But shape rendering is something that it knows about, so you can see which shape took how much time. You can see that contents and content zone was relatively slow. Well, the whole thing was very fast. The 35 milliseconds is entirely fine. But rendering the content items, specifically what happened in the content zone is rendering the blog, and the corresponding blog posts took the most amount of time, which is kind of understandable because that's really pretty much the only thing that happens on this page. But what's even more interesting here is, well, first of all, this timeline and everything related to the details here with SQL queries. Of course, as I said, performance is not only the server response time, but also how long it takes for the user to actually see the content. So the whole page to be rendered, including all the static resources being loaded and executed. And we see a basic timeline of that here as well. First the request, and then everything related to the HTML document. in developer tools like Chrome Dev Tools, you see a much more granular overview of this with a lot of insights on what exactly is happening. This is just a crude overview. But we also see that roughly one-fourth of the time it took to serve this request was spent in SQL. So let's see the details there. And that's usually the case. Usually in an Orchard application, what's slow is something with the database. It's almost always database operations. Not necessarily because the database itself is slow. Sometimes that can also happen, but because the queries are inefficient, or there are too many queries that your code or Orchard's code is issuing. But in any case, somehow the culprit is with queries. And if you check out the queries down here, you will also be able to understand it a bit better what happens in the database. We see from here, as well as from here, that we have actually two queries, but I see there is also a bit of a repeating here. In any case, you see that first of all, we have this query. This query is something from the document table, and then joins, and then the where clauses, which is interesting. We have a filtering on the content item ID being this one. This pretty much means that we fetch the content item with this ID. This is most possibly our blog. So that looks all right. Probably we can optimize something on this query. But this is coming from Orchard, so not really much to do there. If you notice that this query or such queries take a lot of time, what you can do is that you can add SQL indices even on these two columns. I think they do have indices actually, but you may notice that for your particular use case, the indices that Orchard provides out of the box are either not suitable or not enough. But this took like 3.7 milliseconds, so not much. Altogether, the database operations took 1/4 of the request, but none of them are really slow. Again, we have something like almost 1 millisecond query here, which is, again, something on the document table. The document table being, of course, that stores the JSON documents, as we have seen a while ago. Commonly, there are joins. These joins are almost always on some kind of index table. In this case, as well, it's on the content item index table. So that's quite usual. And yeah, again, we are fetching a content item, or fetching content items based on this ID, but we are fetching content items based on this ID being their container. This list content item ID means that we are using list part to fetch items that are contained in the item with this ID. What this happens here, of course, is that the blog uses list part, and first we loaded the blog here, and then we load all the blog posts which are contained in that blog. As you see, pretty standard query. It's also fast. Well, there is one blog post in the system, so it ought to be fast. And then we have two other queries here. Well, so altogether we have actually four queries, not two, as indicated at the top. This query, again, document table, again, content item index, and again, based on the ID. Probably this is one of the widgets, and we have a very similar query with a different ID here. Well, it's actually the same query with a different ID here, which should be another widget. So if you notice that one of these is very slow, again, none of these are really slow, 1-3 milliseconds, that's not much. But it depends on your use case. Probably this is too slow for you, and it's supposed to be faster. Or you notice that that certain queries take a lot of time. Then you can look at the query, start to understand what the query is about. There will always be some telltale signs that will allow you to quickly correlate the query with something that's happening in the system, especially it's about your own code. In these cases, you will notice that we have these content item IDs here. These are always simple ways to correlate it. Commonly, what you would have is that in your code, you would have some kind of iSession query, as we have already seen, for person pages. And in that query, you would have some filtering, and that filtering would be slow. Probably because it will be some complex filtering, or probably there would be a lot of items, a lot of records, a lot of rows in that table. Probably the latency to your database server is very, very large, and you have to do something, and you will notice that even simple queries like this take 20 milliseconds. That's most possibly not because the database server is replying slowly, although that can be the case as well. And with small queries like this, it's also not because the queries are too complex, but the response that your web app receives from the database server takes a lot of time. Latency to the database server can really kill an Orchard application's performance. Because no matter how you optimize your queries, you will still have a couple of SQL queries on every page load. If an SQL query takes something like 20 milliseconds, then with five queries, it's already 100 milliseconds. That's very much noticeable. And especially if the latency is more, or you have more queries, and your page load does some other stuff than just firing those five queries. So usually it's a good approach to use mini profiler first if you find something good. Some specific operation in your application is slow. It might show you the issue right away. And also you can use this in any environment. Since you have seen, you just turn it on and that's it. You don't need to attach a Visual Studio profiler to it or any other kind of profiler. It's very lightweight, very simple to use, works everywhere. And because of this, it's also very effective. I mentioned that it's not running on the admin, but this is by default. As explained in the Orchard Core documentation, you can also configure it to run on the admin from the app settings file. Or there's also a quick trick that you can use is that you load the admin page, and then you go to the front end. And then there will be actually two such little widgets here. One of them will correspond to the previous admin page load. You see, this is now for admin/features. Just a quick trick. Otherwise, Orchard, of course, is as .NET as usual. So you can use any .NET profiler. You can use something like Application Insights, New Relic, or some other kind of application performance monitoring tool to collect performance data once the application is deployed. Similarly, you can collect any kind of telemetry from the server. So nothing really Orchard specific here, apart from the mini profiler being a feature enable away.